Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this little chat about how multimeters work and burden voltage. Now, this is something which certainly the folks are more experienced in electronics should or probably will be aware of, but I'm sure there are quite a few folk out there who hear the term burden voltage and in respect to measuring current, and it's a bit confusing understanding what effect burden voltage can have on measuring current. And why use the term voltage when you're talking about current? So I thought we'd cover that off. I'm going to do some practical examples on the bench to show you the dramatic effect that a multimeter can have when you're trying to measure current, particularly smaller currents when you're trying to measure milliamps and microamps. Now this came out when I was doing the current measurements on the CMOS version of the 555 timer. And folks there were saying, well, careful, isn't burden voltage perhaps playing a role in what you're doing? Now, I, in that exercise, had actually come across when I was playing with the microamp range on my multimeter, saw that it was having an effect. And that's why I specifically used the milliamp range, so that it wasn't having too much of an effect. But nonetheless, it's something we need to be careful about. And it's quite interesting understanding how and why that effect takes place. And ultimately, we're going to end up talking about Dave Jones's microcurrent. In essence, he's developed a very simple little device, but very handy and very useful for an issue which virtually all multimeters fail at and fall over at. And when I say virtually all, even my very top-end 3458A suffers from the same problem. Right then, so the first thing we kind of want to have a look at and talk about before we get in and actually have a look at the perhaps failings of a multimeter in this regard is understanding how a multimeter takes its measurements. Now, this is a very simplistic look at it. It's a high-level overview, but many people might be aware that the multimeter uses a very fundamental way to do its measurements. Now, it's called a multimeter because it does multiple measurements. It's not just measuring voltage, it's not just measuring current, it's not just measuring, let's say, capacitance or resistance. You can get individual voltmeters or ammeters, but this is a multimeter, it does multiple measurements. So it almost assumes that it's actually measuring current and it's actually measuring capacitance and resistance, but actually it's not. On a very simple level, all it's measuring is voltage. And once you have an understanding of that, then also understanding the issues with burden voltage are perhaps easier to understand. So let's have a look at that. Right then. So let's just have a look at a sample of some of the measurements you can possibly do on your multimeter and how it's actually done internally on the multimeter. So the first one I'm going to start off with is capacitance. So measuring capacitors. So you'd obviously connect up your capacitor to your multimeter, and normally that would be between the common and the actual voltage input, which also does the capacitance. So what is the multimeter doing? Because it's not directly measuring farads. What it's doing, it actually sends a known current through the capacitor, charging it up, and it measures the voltage, or when it hits a certain voltage level, with respect to the time. So it measures how long it takes filling it up at a certain rate with a certain current to reach a certain voltage level over time. It then will also discharge it and do the same thing, and it'll actually continue doing that. And from that, it's now got the parameters with a formula internal to its little microcontroller unit to work out capacitance. But ultimately, what is it measuring? It's measuring the voltage. Yes, it's including time, but its measurement is actually voltage. Let's have a look at resistance. So when you connect a resistor, again, what you're doing, you're probably connecting to the common and the voltage input, which also does resistance. Again, the multimeter sends a known current through the resistor. And what it's doing over here, it's measuring the voltage drop across the resistor. And using Ohm's law, it's got its little microcontroller inside, and it's just doing a little bit of Ohm's law. Resistance is equal to V over I. It knows V because it's measured the voltage. It's given a known current through there, so it's got I. So it's able to work out R and display resistance in ohms. But what is it measuring? It's measuring voltage. Then we get to current. When we're measuring current, we will generally speaking have a circuit, and to measure current in a circuit, we have to break the circuit and put the meter in series with that circuit. So here I've got a battery, which is supplying the energy to this light bulb. And in that circuit, we're going into the multimeter so we can measure the current. So internally, what is a multimeter doing? Well, internally, it actually has its own resistor. And in this case, the resistor is called a shunt resistor because it's got a value and hopefully a precision value, so that's fairly stable with temperature. And it's a known value to the multimeter, and it's simply measuring the voltage drop across that resistor. You've already got the current flowing through there. You've got the voltage drop due to that current flow through there. And again, it's using Ohm's law. It's got the voltage because it's measuring the voltage across that resistor. It knows the value of that resistor or that shunt resistor. And I equals V over R, again, it's this little microcontroller internally, does a calculation with Ohm's law, but it's measuring voltage, does a calculation and displays the current in amps. So ultimately, for the most part, all your multimeter is doing is measuring voltage. However, so here is the challenge with when we come to measure current. And you can see that quite clearly with a circuit. What's happening? To be able to measure current, we're putting a resistor into that circuit. And obviously, with any basic understanding of electronics, and again with Ohm's law, if you're going to add resistance into the circuit, you're potentially going to affect the way it operates. You're going to have a voltage drop over here. And that's where the term burden voltage comes from. It's a burden. It's something ultimately you don't want there, but you need that to be able to take that measurement. In this case, there are other ways to take current measurements by using transducers, which obviously aren't a part of the circuit, but there the measurements potentially aren't that accurate. But as we'll see, even this method creates issues. Now, that level of resistance, one would hope, if you're doing a measurement like this, one would hope that if you are putting a measurement device in series and it's got resistance, that resistance value will be low. So if you put it on your like 10 amp scale, you'll find that the current shunt in there, and we're going to measure it, and I'll show you on the bench, will be, and this will vary between multimeters, will be anywhere around 0.1 ohm. So that's not a huge amount, but nonetheless, even 0.1 ohm can have an effect on a circuit. But if you're dealing with higher voltages, the voltage drop across there potentially isn't really going to affect the operation of your circuit. So that's something to be aware of. If you are very concerned about the effect of the resistance in your circuit playing a part in your circuit, always try to go to the highest current range on your multimeter. And that 10 ohm setting or the higher ohm setting will have the least resistance and have the least effect on your circuit. However, generally speaking, that range, for one, you're going to have less resolution. You're not going to be able to measure really small currents. Like you might get down to milliamps, but you're not going to get much less than milliamps and certainly not microamps. And also the accuracy in that range is, generally speaking, not as good as the lower ranges. Once you start getting down to the milliamp range, so you change your plug on your multimeter, that current shunt value, resistor value, starts going up to like 1, 1.8, 2 ohms. And in a circuit which is already, let's say you've got a circuit with a low voltage, if you're passing a lot of current, the more current you pass through there, the higher the voltage drop. So if you've got a reasonable amount of current going through there, and let's say a 2 ohm, 1.8 or 2 ohm resistor, you're now going to be dropping a voltage over there, which should be going and operating your circuit. You're going to have a voltage drop or a burden voltage over here. And that's where the challenge comes in. And it gets even worse if you go to your microamp range. Often the current shunt is in the order of around 100 ohms. You're putting 100 ohms in circuit to try and get a measurement. Now, when we get to the bench, I'm going to demonstrate that and perhaps just try and explain the logic of why they use those. And then we'll obviously see the benefit of the microcurrent that Dave Jones developed. When I do multimeter reviews, for the most part, I always try and remember to include a test to note the burden voltage. In some of the later ones, I've actually forgotten, but it's something I need to do because it's an important parameter to know. And often you'll see noted that is measured as millivolts per milliamp. So you might have, let's say, a drop of 1 millivolt for each milliamp, or they'll give a scale of so many millivolts per microamps. And obviously you've got to scale that up. If your circuit is running at 300 milliamps, well, then you've got to multiply that to see what your voltage drop or your burden voltage is going to be on the circuit. Let's get down to the bench.
Right, so to start off this practical demonstration, what we're going to do, we're just going to use the multimeter to measure a current flowing through a circuit. So I've got my power supply, it's set to 2 volts. We're currently drawing 100 milliamp. I've got my electronic DC load, so that's acting as the load, and it's a load that I can vary. And then we've obviously got the multimeter in series to do the measurement. So this is very much like the circuit I was showing you. We've got the multimeter in series with the circuit. That's my electronic DC load, is the load over there. And the power source, the battery over here, or the cell, is my power supply. So you can quite happily see that the multimeter is showing us a reading in amps, but as I said, internally, it's using a shunt to see measure a voltage drop, use Ohm's law, and derive the current reading for the display. So let's go about that and actually use a shunt. So what I'm going to do, I've got a 1 ohm resistor here. We're going to use this as a current shunt and do the same measurement. Right, so now I've gone and changed out the multimeter. I've removed it from the circuit. It's not in the circuit measuring current anymore. It's actually outside the circuit measuring the voltage across that 1 ohm resistor. So that's very much like what it's doing internally. So we've got the current shunt, which I've got, and I've got the multimeter measuring the voltage drop. And if we use Ohm's law, we can then actually work out the current. So if we have a look at the circuit, we can actually see the voltage drop across that 1 ohm resistor is 0.1 volts or 100 millivolts. And in this case, because we're using a 1 ohm value, Ohm's law works out very nicely. If you do the calculation, that equates to 100 milliamps, which is what is flowing through the circuit. So here we've got almost a direct reading on the multimeter, which is now out of the circuit. And if we change the current, I can almost exactly read the voltage reading and from that understand what current is flowing. And that's obviously internally what the multimeter does when you've actually got it on the current setting. However, I've still got this 1 ohm resistor in the circuit, and that can potentially play a part. So let's just have a look at the actual values of the resistors or shunts inside the multimeter, and then see how they play a part in the circuit. Right, so I've got another multimeter here set to the resistance setting, and I've got my Fluke over here set to the milliamp range, milliamp and the main 10 amp range. So what I'm going to do, we're literally just going to measure the resistance of the shunts by measuring the actual current inputs. So I select, there we go, I put that in, and this is the value of the 10 amp shunt. So it's around 0.1 ohm. So you can actually take a multimeter and go and measure it. Now I'm going to go into the milliamp, and on the Fluke, we can see that it's around 1.88 or close to 2 ohm, but internally the meter will exactly know that value, will be calibrated, so it uses a precise value for its measurements when it's actually applying Ohm's law to work out the current flow. So that's already at 1.8, close to 2 ohm. Next, I'm going to switch to the microamp range, 100 ohm. So you can do this exercise yourself if you have 2 multimeters, is go and measure the resistance of your current inputs with another multimeter. And as you can see, it's 100 ohm on the microamp scale on the Fluke. And it's very similar across other meters. I say, even my very expensive top end 3458A has similar values and similar issues when trying to measure small currents. Right, so in this example, what we're going to do, we're going to show the effect of what happens when your current starts to increase over your current shunt and you're doing a measurement. So again, we've got the power supply, which is obviously supplying our energy. I've got our load, and I've got the Sanwah multimeter measuring the voltage across the actual load itself. Now, we're going to use the Fluke 87 to take the measurements, but at the moment, I've not got it in the circuit. I've got it out of circuit, and as we can see, we're supplying about 1.7 milliamp, close to 2 milliamp, and we've got our voltage at our load. So this is our load, and we need to pretend that, let's say, this load to function properly needs, let's say, between 1.8 to 2 volts to actually operate correctly. And as we can see, it's right up there at the moment. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to connect the Fluke. So there we go. I've now got the Fluke in circuit. We'll just switch it to DC. never mind the negative, that's just the way I've got it connected up. And it's also measuring about 1.74 milliamp. If we were splitting ball hairs, there was a slight voltage drop, but the current's still low. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to slowly increase the current on the actual load itself. As I start increasing the current, look what's happening to the actual voltage at the load. Remember, more current over that current shunt means you're getting a greater voltage drop inside the fluke. And because that's dropping the voltage, that's been taken away from the voltage at the load. So let's step it up. Let's say our little circuit needs about 200 milliamp to operate. Well, look, already at 100 milliamp, which we're measuring, and we've already dropped to 1.8 volts. So let's just double check that. If I pull the fluke out of circuit, and I just hold these together, see where we're up to? We're back up to our operating voltage of 2 volts. So it's definitely the fluke and its internal current shunt which is dropping that voltage. Let's go to 200 milliamp. There we go, 200 milliamp. I'm now down to 1.62 volts. And in many cases, that might prevent a circuit or an IC from operating correctly. And that's the challenge. So there's two things happening here. For one, we're dropping a voltage which might prevent our circuit from operating properly. And two, by having a resistance in the path of the circuit, you're also limiting the current flow, which is the very thing you're trying to measure. So that all means that trying to obtain accurate readings on it with a multimeter on certainly the lower current levels where the current shunt value is increasing becomes a challenge. We'll just pop it into the big 10 amp. So I popped it into the 10 amp. And again, because that current shunt is so low, you can see now it's having far less of an effect. But the issue here is you don't have the resolution that you would on the milliamp scale and potentially the accuracy. Let's see what happens when we go back to milliamp. So we've got it on milliamps. We've got that current drop of 1.6. Now I'm going to switch it over to microamps. Now we might be over the limit because our current level is high, but just want to show you what that current shunt's going to do. Bang. It virtually wipes out the operation of the circuit because it's dropping so much voltage. Let's just drop the current. So I almost have to drop the current right off to small levels in this case. And so that same problem exists if you're measuring small circuits on the microamp scale. Obviously, the lower current initially means you're going to have a lower voltage drop, but you've got a far bigger resistor or far bigger shunt inside the meter. So it only takes a small increase in the current for suddenly that voltage drop across that 100 ohm internal shunt to become an issue. Right, so let's go back to the situation where we're trying to improve things. So this time I haven't got the fluke in circuit. It's measuring the voltage drop across the 1 ohm shunt. So the 1 ohm is certainly better than, let's say, the 1.8 or nearly 2 ohm internal shunt of the actual multimeter itself. So we want to have the circuit kind of maintain at least 1.8 volts because that, let's pretend that's what it needs to operate. And it needs that at about 200 milliamp. So as I dial things up, you can see we're measuring the voltage drop, and because we've got a nice value of 1 ohm, and I've got this on millivolts, the actual reading on the meter, 41.43, relates directly to the current reading. So now if I take things up to 100 milliamp, or just over, we're still above our 1.8. But remember previously, when we got up to 200 milliamp, we didn't sustain our 1.8 volts. So let's go. So here we go, at 200 milliamp, we are just about at the level where the circuit supposedly would work. Now let's say the circuit happened to be a 1.2 volt circuit, an IC, and we were dropping that much voltage, you'd probably find the circuit wouldn't work. So how can we go one step better? Well, we could get a low resistance shunt. So what I've done, because I don't have a 0.1 ohm shunt, I've got 10 1 ohm resistors and I've wrapped them together. The resistance value, including the cables of this, is about 0.11 ohm. So not far off, but we're not looking for precision here. We're trying to demonstrate something. So I'm going to put this in circuit and use this as a shunt now. Right, so I've got our new 0.1 ohm shunt in circuit. And we're going to step up the current. Because it's 0.1 ohm, obviously our reading on our display in millivolts is going to be slightly different. But let's just step up. So we've got 44 milliamp, and as you can see, the comma is in the wrong place now if we're looking directly on the actual meter itself. We've lost some resolution because we've got a lower voltage drop. But nonetheless, if we move the comma, 44.4 milliamp is what's been shown on the meter itself. Now let's step things up to 100. Now you can already note at 100 milliamp, look, I've only dropped two counts on the voltage over here. Let's go all the way up to 200 milliamp. And this is where previously on the 1 ohm, I was already at below 1.8. And look, I've only dropped that. So that shows you the beauty of using a smaller current shunt in an exercise like this. And you can do this practically at home as well. This has got some very handy applications. For instance, you can use an oscilloscope and use a shunt like this and actually measure current on an oscilloscope. And that's an exercise that we'll go through as well at some point in time. So that's great. This 1.1 ohm shunt is having far less effect on our circuit. But the challenge here is, and I'm doing a little bit of thumb suck here, is that, so the question here is, why don't they use something like a 0.1 ohm current shunt inside the multimeter so that has less effect on the circuit? And I'm going to do a little bit of a thumb suck here because I'm not 100% sure, but obviously with that lower value, you get less of a voltage drop. So your resolution and your reading on the actual meter itself is less. You don't have the greater voltage to work with because you've got a low resistance value. And so if you want those really fine readings, let's say down into the milliamps and the microamps, you've got a challenge because then you need a far higher resolution on the actual voltage reading within the multimeter to be able to do that. Whereas if you're using a larger value resistor, you've got a higher voltage drop. You can get those readings far easier with less resolution on the actual voltage measurement reading side on the multimeter itself. So how do you get around that? So ultimately what you want to do, if you're going to try and measure low current or currents accurately in a circuit, you do want a small value shunt. But you've got the problem in that you've got a lower voltage drop coming off to measure with. So how do you get around that? You amplify that signal. And if you've got a very good amplifier, a very precise, clean amplifier, you can then amplify that voltage drop you've got off your current shunt. And that amplified value can then give you the reading and the resolution you want on your meter. And that's exactly what Dave Jones's microcurrent does. Right then, so there you have it. Hopefully that gives you a reasonable understanding for one, the internal workings of the multimeter and how they can affect the measurement of a circuit, particularly when you're measuring current. And hats off to Dave Jones for his microcurrent, because that little project, that very little simple device, which is simply using a nice, precise, a low value resistance current shunt, which is then amplified using a very precise amplifier to allow your multimeter to actually take a voltage reading, which will correlate to the current, allows you to measure milliamps, microamps, even down to nanoamps in some cases. So many people have asked me to pull out my microcurrent. I have tried several times over the last couple of years to actually purchase one, and each time I go and try and purchase one, they're sold out. I've looked on Adafruit. I know Dave Jones has got a new version, the microcurrent gold, and as far as I can see, that's already sold out. They cost about $60, but $60 for what it provides you with is a brilliant price. So certainly one day I hopefully will get one in my hands, because I've got other applications which I know I can use it for besides just actually using it with a multimeter. So certainly now that you realize the potential hiccups with using a multimeter in series trying to measure current, have a look out for Dave Jones's microcurrent, because it'll go a long way to helping you measure those circuits which have potentially got small currents or even larger currents but low voltage, low operating voltage, which can particularly pose an issue when you're trying to measure those in terms of proper functioning of the circuit and the current flow in the circuit that you're trying to measure. But anyway, I hope you gained some value from that. If you did, give us a thumbs up and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.